Thank you so much for joining us. I'd also like to thank Matt and Tony for their technical support, our closed caption team, and Elizabeth Moy, Roy's program coordinator, who really put much of this together. My name is Ganit Ancori. I am the interim Henry and Lois Foster Director and Chief Curator of the Rose Art Museum. I'm thrilled to welcome you to our closing program titled Yesterday's Tomorrow, Activating History Today, generously supported by Jolie Schwab and David Hodes. Before we begin, I wish to acknowledge that the Rose Art Museum occupies Nipmuc and Massachusetts homelands and territories, and that the very existence of our museum here has been facilitated by the violent dispossession, enslavement, and dispersal of multiple indigenous communities by settler colonialism. As we strive to repair relationships with Native peoples and with the land, the Rose commits to actively learn from, respect, and amplify Native voices by pursuing partnerships with Indigenous artists and communities. This land acknowledgement is but one aspect of the path we are pursuing in an ongoing effort to reimagine the Rose Art Museum as an anti-racist, anti-colonial, diverse and inclusive nexus for art, communities, and justice. Today's program relates to our overarching goals, and like this living land statement that I shared, strives to remember and memorialize, to collect and recollect the past, to uncover and repair the repressed, overlooked, and invisibilized narratives that connect our histories and traumas with the current moment of racial reckoning. The Rose team and I are thrilled to be in partnership with Now and There, the Robbins House, and Revolutionary Spaces, whose recent projects lend unique insight and fresh perspectives on contemporary practices of making memorials and remembering. Leah Triplett Harrington, assistant curator at Now and There, will have the honor of welcoming my brilliant and inspiring colleagues, Professors Lauren Woods and Maria Madison. But first, it is my great pleasure to welcome Caitlin Julia Rubin, our associate curator and director of programs. Caitlin?
Well, thank you, Ganit, and thanks again to all of you who have joined us here this evening. I'm Caitlin Rubin, and I had the pleasure of organizing our current, though not for very long, exhibition Yesterday's Tomorrow, Selections from the Rose Collection, 1924 through 2018. It's a privilege to mark its closure with tonight's program and with such a fantastic cohort of collaborators and thought partners. But before we jump in, I wanted to just provide a quick overview and orientation to tonight's Zoom room as is necessary, so that all can fully participate. So first, we're pleased to offer live closed captioning. You can enable or disable this feature by clicking the closed caption button, which is labeled CC, often at the bottom of your video window. Also on your screen will be a Q&A button. If you have a question for our presenters, please click on this and type it into the text field. Maria and Lauren will both be sharing research from their recent projects in back-to-back presentations of about 20 minutes each. After this, we'll open up the conversation to questions, and we're going to do our best to respond to as many as we can before the close of the program. Finally, we'll be leaving the chat open today. So this is a small way, hopefully, to help us feel connected to one another, even though we can't be in the same space or even see all of your faces. But we just request that if you could help us by ensuring that your questions go into the Q&A box and not the chat. This will just keep us organized and help us find all of those questions when it comes time for them. So though the exhibitions Yesterday's Tomorrow actually first opened in February, in-person visits to the museum and to the exhibition have for most of its run been restricted. Due to COVID-19 guidelines, the museum's physical galleries are currently open only to our Brandeis campus community. But since tonight's program expands upon themes central to the show, I thought I'd take a few minutes to take us through our galleries in this digital space And we can share some of the works that we've been living with and thinking about over the last few months together. Yesterday's Tomorrow continues a series of recent exhibitions that looks closely at new narrative threads and connections across the Rose's permanent collection. The show brings together works by artists who wrestle with the imprint of the past upon the present, and also as well as the challenges of how their own current moment might be given a representative form that could hold up within a future that is yet to come. A sense of chronological confusion is at the heart of this exhibition. Because despite language used to describe it, the past is rarely stilled within the fixed frame of retrospective distance. Instead, its images and its narratives echo at the edges or are even transposed on top of the present, shading visions of the future. And then interwoven with and twisted by current events and shifting perspectives, individual and collective understandings of this history are forever in flux. So rather than adapt a static frame, the objects in yesterday's tomorrow move away from the form of the traditional inflexible monument to make room for layered narratives and the intimate sway of memory. In doing so, I'd argue that they mirror the slippery footing with which we navigate our own standing and approach both to an envisioned yesterday and to an imagined tomorrow. And with that, it's my pleasure to introduce and hand the Zoom mic over to my co-moderator for the evening, Leah Triplett Harrington. Leah is a friend and a colleague, a curator, a writer, and an editor. She joins us tonight as assistant curator for Now and There, where she facilitates the Public Art Accelerator Program and organizes large-scale public art commissions, projects that have, even in recent months, opened new means of engaging with and activating our city's streets and parks. As an independent curator, Leah has organized projects for Boston University Art Galleries, Trestle Gallery, and others. And many of you, of course, also know her writing, published recently in Flash Art, Hyperallergic, WBUR's The Artery, Big Red and Shiny, and The Brooklyn Rail. Leah is also a founding editor of the publication and platform The Rib, and an editor at large for the Boston Art Review. So Leah, thank you very much for partnering with us on this program and for being here tonight.
Thank you so much, Caitlin. That was amazing. I'm so excited to be here with you all. I'm so thankful to you, Caitlin, and to the Rose and Elizabeth and everyone who made this program possible tonight. I'm also really excited to introduce our speakers, Lauren Woods and Dr. Maria Madison. And I'll introduce both and then I'll turn it over to them and we'll get started. Lauren Woods is Assistant Professor of Fine Arts at Brandeis University and is a conceptual artist whose interdisciplinary projects, film, video, sound installation, socially engaged public intervention, and site-specific work engage history and socio-political systems to critique structures of power. Her primary research traces racial histories in the built environment through monument and memorial work. Driving Woods' critical and creative inquiry is the question of how best to translate the practice of traditional monument making into new contemporary objects of public memory that serve for the movement for racial and historical justice. Lauren will be discussing her research for the conceptual design in progress, Crispus in July, a public artwork curated by Now and There and commissioned by Revolutionary Spaces for the 250th anniversary of the Boston Massacre in March 2020. Revolutionary Spaces is a new organization founded at the start of this year to explore the ongoing American struggle and to create and sustain a free society as evoked by the two buildings that it cares for, Boston's Old South Meeting House and the Old State House. And as for us, Now and There is a nonprofit dedicated to temporary and site-specific public art projects, hence our name. And we often partner with other nonprofits to curate and produce projects like Crispus in July. Crispus in July was planned as the 2020 programmatic centerpiece at Revolutionary Spaces, along with a new play for addicts, about addicts by Boston-based playwright Miranda Adekoje. And reflecting addicts now on view at the Old State House and also online at revolutionaryspaces.org, which is a really excellent exhibition that I hope you guys all check out. Dr. Maria Madison is director for the Institute on Assets and Social Policy and associate dean for diversity, equity, and inclusion at the Heller School for Social Policy and Management at Brandeis University. Since 1983, Dr. Madison has built her career around evidence-based research methods. This has included conducting and supervising significant research projects on multicultural and clinical global issues focused on diverse populations and settings, particularly involving marginalized populations from the Democratic Republic of the Congo, previously known as Zaire and Cameroon. Parallel to this career, Dr. Madison spent 17 years managing clinical research studies, including in the private sector. She also founded the nonprofit museum, the Robbins House Incorporated, which is a historic site with a conceptual framework of reducing race bias through teaching history. She is also an adjunct professor and contractor with Partners in Health University for Global Health Equity in Rwanda, an associate editor for the Journal of Health Equity and principal investigator for the work on mental health and race equity. I'm really excited, especially to hear from Dr. Madison tonight, speak about the Robbins House, and I'm so thrilled for Dr. Madison and Lauren to be in conversation with each other. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to, she's here, Dr. Madison, and then Lauren will speak and we'll come back for a little Q&A.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be invited to present a project that's been near and dear to myself, my family, my community for the last two decades. And to start, I want to quote W.E.B. Du Bois, who said, "The slave went free, stood a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again towards slavery." What he was referring to was the Reconstruction era. And in particular, during that era, the Civil Rights and Voting Rights Acts that were first carried forward. In the words of Nicole Hannah Jones, she describes as well that America wasn't a democracy until Black America made it one. And the stories I'm about to describe in the next few minutes portray these compelling through lines of the long civil rights movement. Before I start, I'm just gonna describe a little bit about Reconstruction. And that during Reconstruction, the United States government made a determined effort to protect the rights of African Americans, bolstered by a series of legislative acts and constitutional amendments. African Americans' participation in government reached its highest point during the Reconstruction era, which spans the middle of the 1800s, 1866 to around 1877. And there's some debate, I believe, around the exact years. Unfortunately, the brief moment of progress came to a close when the federal government pulled back from Reconstruction in the 1870s. Many of the laws aimed at protecting African Americans' rights were circumvented by local courts and legislatures unwilling to allow African Americans to participate in government. By 1910, most African Americans living in the South had been disenfranchised. This is the Robbins House story and the way we share this narrative. One moment, sorry. I'd like to draw you into our nonprofit. We refer to it as the Robbins House Incorporated because it commemorates the legacy of a previously enslaved Revolutionary War veteran of the North in Concord, Massachusetts. This is the house. It's approximately 544 square feet. And one family lived on the right side and another family lived on the left side. It's called a knee wall house, which was traditional for farmers. And another interesting thing about this house, before I draw you into the narrative of one of its inhabitants, Ellen Garrison, is that the house was originally located on the outskirts of Concord, Massachusetts, which is considered to be the pivotal point in the Revolutionary War. And it was pivotal because there across the river, the Concord River, was the North Bridge, which was the location of the first successful battle in the Revolutionary War. In other words, it was that place in which the Minutemen, who picked up their muskets, turned the Redcoats back for the first time, having the first successful battle. And what they were fighting for, in their words, was against slavery from King George, despite the fact that they themselves had enslaved individuals. And so begins our story. because we actually have acquired the house that Caesar Robbins' descendants had originally lived in. And in the top left-hand corner of this slide, you can see that same house that you saw in the URL in the website. And that house was originally inhabited by Caesar Robbins' son, Peter, on one side, and his daughter, Susan, on the other side. And what our project tries to do, what our nonprofit tries to do, is to present a balanced and deep history of the through line of the long civil rights movement. And what I mean by that is to return to the landscape, not just the descriptions of who was enslaved, and there was slavery in the North, and also the bills of sale around those exchanges. And this is an example of a bill of sale in the middle of this slide. But also to state that if we're going to commemorate and remember people only as slaves, why would we do that if we're not marking as well enslavers? So we discuss how to create balance in the telling of this through line of this story, not just raising awareness about slavery, but reconstruction and then the subsequent movements that came from that, and discussing enslavers as well as those who were enslaved. And so as a part of that narrative, we try to raise awareness around how everyone was engaged in that activity, including some of the more well-known people of this historic town that's usually known for its writers, Henry David Thoreau, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Louisa May Alcott, and others, but as well were citizens who bought and sold a certain Negro girl being a slave about 2 years of age called Nancy, as written in one of the bills of sale, or a Negro boy, a slave named Cato, being about 6 years old and something more, or to Anne Prescott to Jonas Haywood, 1755, a Negro man named Titus, also included type transcripts of 1740 and 1755 bills of sale. All in all, probably 12 families built their wealth from having freed labor in their households, and also from owning plantations in the South or benefiting from the proceeds of those plantations. So it's within that context that one of our pivotal individuals in this narrative arose. Her grandfather was Caesar, the previously enslaved Revolutionary War veteran, but also her father was a fugitive enslaved man from New Jersey. And he found his way to Concord, and he stays in Concord. And then we begin to learn who these individuals are. Imagine yourself going into the house. You can see the wood floor slats on the bottom. And we begin to learn the stories of how others describe them. One individual referred to Ellen and her siblings, who were born and raised in that house, as very bright and intelligent, good scholars. And yet in some of the Henry David Thoreau journal entries, you'll note that the same family was considered to be outcasts, because the Black families were situated on the less than arable land on the outer skirts of the center of Concord. And further stories describe how they were perhaps received. Despite being good scholars, they were also ill-treated and crowded out. When we begin to hear first-person stories, though, we get an idea of their fortitude and what their experiences are and their perspectives. And the most important periods are when Ellen turns 20. She's born and raised in Concord, and then she's a good scholar, she becomes a teacher. As a part of that, moving to Boston, hosting anti-slavery events as well. But by the time Reconstruction comes around, she is inspired to become a teacher of the newly freed people in the South. And she begins to write 100 letters and 50 school reports and signs 4 petitions. And I'm just gonna share with you a couple of those letters and the petitions. In particular, before I describe the letter she wrote as a teacher in the South, I'm gonna talk about a petition that she wrote. This is what they look like. I don't know if you can see this well. This is like a show and tell through Zoom. But this is what the petitions look like, and they're available through the Harvard Archives for Anti-Slavery Petitions. And Ellen, at the age of 23, or 20, signs a petition that not only is to end slavery, but but it was also to try and promote the freedom of all citizens to move freely in public transportation. She signs that in 1843. That petition is not ratified or approved, but 1844, another petition is carried forward. And in that petition, Ralph Waldo Emerson and his wife sign it. And that petition states, it has three provisions, but it states as well that slavery should be abolished. And then there's a second and third provision that says, not only should slavery be abolished, but all people should be allowed to move freely on public transportations and sit wherever they would like. What we know in this complicated era then, which is similar all the way through to today, is that Ralph Waldo Emerson and his wife, Lydian, signed next to their name in that 1844 petition, not including the sections 2 and 3. In other words, Ralph and Lydian Emerson were saying that they agree slavery should be abolished, but Blacks and whites shouldn't sit together. And they didn't approve that freedom of movement on the railroads or in any public setting. So I bring that up because it's within this context that we see again what Du Bois was speaking about. The slave went free, stood a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again towards slavery through the life of Ellen Garrison. Because it's within her 100 letters that we begin to see that she's not only asking to go and teach the newly freed people of the South, but she's describing it in her beautiful language and her wonderful handwriting. I have a great desire to go and labor among the freedmen of the South. I think it's our duty as a people to spend our lives in trying to elevate our own race. She goes on to say, who can feel for us if we do not feel for ourselves? And who can feel the sympathy that we can who are identified with them? So she begins to teach. She's allowed to join what is referred to as the American Missionary Association, which was hired by the Freedmen's Bureau, which was created to help provide lands and education for newly freed people and those who fought during the Civil War. And so what we begin to see through her letters is that not only is she beginning to experience a kind of discrimination that she hadn't experienced before, but that it is painful. In particular, in one of her letters, she describes how she is going to sit in a train station, most likely because where she was living was burned down. And so she goes to a train station and she's sitting in the train station. She decides she's going to sit in the white women's waiting room for the train to arrive. And this is 1866. And what she writes in her letter is that she felt that since her friends in Congress had decided or voted to create a bill that should protect their rights, she felt it was upon her to test her rights. What she was referring to was that just 1 month before, the nation had passed the first Civil Rights Act of 1866. And within 1 month, she had determined to test it. We know it's deliberate because she had signed that petition back in 1843. We know it's deliberate that she's sitting there because she states it in her letter. And she describes what occurs to her on that event, that she's thrown out, that she's outrageously abused and insulted. And so she decides to raise a court case against the two different individuals who kick her out of that waiting station. And she raises her court case to the Maryland State grand jury and court. And she begins to describe what happens to her during this case. And I want to just remind everybody, this is well before Rosa Parks is, you know, sitting on the bus and helping to move forward second Reconstruction, if you will. This is in 1866. It's also well before Ida B. Wells tries to do the same thing 50 years later. This is a young woman born and raised in our historic house who's attempting to legally test the nation's first Civil Rights Act. So what we see from her experience is that during that Reconstruction period, the first one, that first act was passed because the nation is also trying to create a balance, equity, if you will, for society. So it's where we see a number of African Americans finally reaching Congress and representing their communities like high end rebels. And so that first Civil Rights Act, 1866, that first Voting Rights Act for Black men in particular, 1870. And here's Ellen testing the first Civil Rights Act within that period. And what we see is that Ellen is, within that period, standing her ground. And I'm going to tell you the outcome of the case in a couple of minutes. But what I want to describe is that first Reconstruction, again, to W.E.B. Du Bois' description, is dismantled. And we see in articles of that time, it's dismantled for the same kinds of reasons that Ralph Waldo Emerson is noting in the petition of 1844, that townspeople didn't want to be ruled by Black people. And so we see this tug of war then of not wanting to have Black representation, not wanting to have towns led by Blacks. And we see the creation of the KKK, Jim Crow laws, Black codes, et cetera. And so the through line, especially for this evening's discussion, is that that was the first Reconstruction. I can just imagine with all of those efforts, if they knew then the second Reconstruction didn't come until 1965 and still voting for Civil Rights Acts, still voting for Voting Rights Acts. And then the through line all the way up to 2013 and today, again, with voter suppression and the need to keep pushing forward for the same civil rights and agency that Ellen demonstrated back in 1866. In essence, we could say it's when we know equity that we come to understand the depth of depravity of what came before and what endures. We don't really know what Ellen looked like, but we can imagine because we've seen these faces, these examples of courage throughout history. On the right-hand side, you can see Leisha Evans, and maybe Ellen looked like Leisha in 2016, where their legs advance while their upper bodies lean back as though recoiling from an unseen force. She's unarmed and unafraid, and she's just protesting. She's standing in the street. We also know the classic photograph of Hazel Bryant, 1957, and Elizabeth Eckford in Little Rock. I've blackened out the image because they've become friends. They've mended, I believe, and moved on from the kind of racism that they were portraying for Blacks. And some of the quotes from the 1840s, again, pivoting us or anchoring us in the emotions, the through line, are captured by an historian, David Breon Davis, in his book, Free Blacks is the Key to Slave Emancipation. Perhaps most important, we are surrounded by white supremacy and are constantly viewed as inferior people in our daily interactions with whites, who sometimes verbally curse or ridicule us or even spit on us in the street, and whose egos climb when we bow or step off the walk to let them pass. It parallels a quote that Ellen writes in her own letters. And in an 1866 letter again from Ellen, she describes, "I have found out one thing about these people. If they attack you, be careful to stand your ground and they will leave you. But if you run, they will follow." The outcome of Ellen's court case again mirrors the demise of the Reconstruction era and that ebb and flow of Black agency and citizenship and rights throughout history. In her letter, she doesn't know the outcome of the court case because she writes about how she's going to sit in the court waiting for her case to be heard. And she writes to one of her supervisors, "Dear friend, we went to the court as requested. The case was not called. Our opponent's counsel consulted ours and requested a compromise, which proposition being expected by us required consideration. We could not agree to compromise though, just then and no other time, unless we can have all our rights conceded to us. The courtroom was crowded and we must stand firm to the last." So you get this sense of this young woman and her steely nerve to keep pushing forward with her court case. I will say that our nonprofit, myself and a colleague of mine, Liz Clayton, had to go to the Maryland State Archives ourselves to find the docket. So this is the actual 1866 docket, and flip through the pages with our gloves on to find the outcome of the court case. And there in the lower line, this is a year or two after we began our search, there in the lower line of this docket, we find the outcome of the case that Ellen launched. And Ellen launched it in April and May. And just a few months later, the outcome of the court case is listed in the docket for July 1866, that the Maryland grand jury dismissed Ellen's court case against the railroad station master. The docket for the dismissal reads, non est, suggesting, and it's translated by a lawyer at the Maryland State Archives, the sheriff's return of process when service is not made because the person was not found, suggesting that Ellen wasn't in the courtroom when they called the case, when we know that's not accurate because she writes about waiting in the waiting room. So Ellen's life is that trajectory of trying to exercise agency and yet having the courts and civil rights and citizenship constantly being challenged throughout the through line. And what we see is with the end of Ellen's court case is the demise of the Reconstruction era, and Ellen loses her teaching job and follows a movement of people through to Kansas, a part of an exoduster movement where they were promised again to have the potential for Black communities with Black agency and Black farming. We realize that that era, those were false promises. Those are more or less dust bowls or less arable land. And we follow her over years as a part of our nonprofit's primary research to see that she spends the rest of her life in Southern California in Pasadena, where she's buried in a cemetery, Mountain View Cemetery in Pasadena, which is in the foothills or near the foothills of Altadena, California. And for those historians in the group, that is also where John Brown's descendants, two of his sons and a daughter, were holding up in the mountains. And that Mountain View Cemetery was described as having been created for John Brown's family and friends and their descendants. So there's a through line, an historical through line that not only helps us understand this ebb and flow of Reconstruction throughout American history and Black history, but also these unified efforts across populations that we see both in Ellen's family as well as John Brown's family and his descendants. So with that, thank you.
Thank you so much, Maria. It's fascinating history of Ellen Garrison. Really, really fascinating. Next, we have Lauren Woods, and after Lauren, we'll come back for our Q&A. So don't forget to put your questions in the Q&A function.
Cool, thank you, Leah. I'm so excited to be doing this program today. It's my first official program since my appointment at Brandeis. This is my second semester, first full year, so this is exciting for me. Let me just share my screen and get started. Let's see. Okay, is this work? Can I get, I don't see anyone, but if someone can tell me they can see my screen, that would be good.
We can see.
Good. Okay, great. Okay, so to get started. So my entry into this panel and participating was about a year ago, last August, and then coming up on the anniversary of proposing this work in December. So last August, I was contacted by Now and There and offered a chance to have my name put into a poll for a commission that was a collaboration between Now and There and at the time, Bostonian Society that was transitioning into this new institution called Revolutionary Spaces as they merged with the old South House. And so I was super excited because it was right up my sort of like, you know, my area of interest, which is history, American history specifically, and Black history, because the Boston Massacre, of course, 250th year anniversary was coming up March 2020, and Revolutionary Spaces had decided in this sort of new launching of the new institution to really sort of look at their mission and think about how ways to open up and history and ways that we can think about history in a more racially just way, as they had already been doing, but a more more sort of prominent public intention around it. And so I was super excited to hear about the effort, which was to take the 250th year anniversary and use that moment to really look at Crispus Attucks, the figure, the mythology, the history. So I was super excited to be offered the chance to think about this history and propose some work. And then in December, I made my sort of initial site visit and meeting in August, the same week that I came for a faculty orientation to start my appointment at Brandeis. And then last November around this time, I made another site visit to really look at the old state the old state house, and really sort of hone this project. So just a little bit about my work. I come from, born in Missouri, but raised in Texas. So I come from the South, have lived here and kind of split my time between here and California. And my practice for the last 15 years has been basically engaged in public practice, public monuments, public history, and public memory, and thinking about new ways of engaging history in what I call interventionist monuments in public space, and would be part of the legacy, I guess, of counter-memorial making and anti-monument making. So here on the screen are some of my earlier works. For me, it's especially since my work is looking or traces sort of the racial history through the built environment and looks at racial justice history to think about and contemplate racial justice in contemporary times. The idea of what that meant or how to work in this way in New England, which was a completely different territory in terms of my interests, my research, and even my lived experience, was a real sort of exciting challenge. So the idea of freedom in New England is completely different than my sort of lived experience or my experience of the word freedom. Being in the South, when we hear the word freedom, right, I automatically go to civil rights history, and that's what a lot of my work is based on. So the idea of going to Boston and walking a freedom trail and that not being about civil rights history was just totally mind-boggling to me. And so I really began to think about this figure of Crispus Attucks, I had a few questions, right? Which is, he's known as the first martyr of liberty for the fight for American independence. And I wanted to really start to engage and understand, what does this hero mythology mean for Black people today? I couldn't answer that for myself. I was pretty ambivalent about it. I wanted to know, should it mean anything anymore? Should Black people today care or lift up the figure of Crispus Attucks at all? Because the record is so sparse, to pin down who this man was and to try to start work from there was really difficult for me. I also had the questions of, what were contemporary Black Bostonians' relationships to American revolutionary history, mythology, and these sites of preservation in the city? And what are the contemporary freedom struggles specific to Black Bostonians today? So I began sort of the inquiry with those questions in mind, and I thought back to my introduction to Crispus Attucks. And of course, for me as a child of parents who came up during the 60s and 70s and had sort of a really political consciousness around Black history and politics, of course I learned the history of Crispus Attucks being a Black man, the first to die for this project called the United States. And that was given to me and many children like me as armor to protect ourselves as we entered into the spaces of education, of, you know, especially public school education. Where we wouldn't necessarily see our own reflections in the history being taught to us. So my first memory of Crispus Attucks comes through the Stevie Wonder song from this album Keys and the Songs in the Key of Life, which was an album that my mother played a lot when I was a child. And for those of you who know this, then you know where I'm going. The song Black Man, which is on the B-side of the first record. And we can, if you see my pointer here, it's right here after the song called Joy Inside My Tears. And let's see, I'm gonna play a quick clip of the song. Oops, let's see if it worked. So, first man to die for the flag that we hold high was a Black man. And that was the song and that beat that I had in my head as I like traveled to Boston to walk the Freedom Trail, right? Like this is sort of the sort of mythology as it exists within my sort of imaginary. And so I understood sort of the gift that had been given to me in terms of this being a sort of Black politic handed to my generation. But I began to, again, wonder, now that we are not necessarily in the project of just representation, just inclusion, just diversity, can we really start to pick apart this mythology as and really start to evaluate sort of or decide what its value is to us, right? And so these are questions swirling in my head. The next place I went, so I visited Boston and I did the Freedom Trail. I sort of did my site visit, stayed in front of the site for a while. And the next sort of moment I had, and I'm still trying to, you know, figure my way through this sort of history, how to begin the research. When I first read The Summation of John Adams, which is from the trial of Rex v. Weems, the soldier's trial, which was the trial that decided the guilt of the soldiers that participated during this conflict, I got to the sort of descriptions of addicts, and that's where I really began to sort of have some clarity. So I'm going to read this little section right here where Adams starts to introduce addicts as a figure. He says, Bailey saw the mulatto 7 or 8 minutes before the firing at the head of 20 or 30 sailors in Cornhill, and he had a large cordwood stick. So that this addict, by this testimony of Bailey, compared with that of Andrew and some others, appears to have undertaken to be the hero of the night and to lead this army with banners, to form them in the first place in Dock Square and march them up to King Street with their clubs. They passed through the main street up to the main guard and in order to make the attack. If this was not an unlawful assembly, there never was one in the world. Addicts, with his, and oh my goodness, I'm gonna say this word wrong, Myrmidons come round Jackson's Corner and down to the party by the sentry box when the soldiers push the people off. This man with his party cried, do not be afraid of them. They dare not fire. Kill them, knock them over. And he tried to knock their brains out. It is plain the soldiers did not leave their station, but cried to the people, stand off. Now to have this reinforcement coming down under the command of a stout mulatto fellow whose very looks was enough to terrify any person, what had not the soldiers then not to fear? He had hardiness enough to fall in upon them, and with one hand took hold of a bayonet, and with the other knocked the man down. This was the behavior of addicts, to whose mad behavior, in all probability, the dreadful carnage of the night is chiefly ascribed. And it is in this manner this town has been often treated. A car from Ireland, an addict from Framingham, happening to be here, shall sally out upon their thoughtless enterprises at the head of such a rabble of Negroes, etc., as they can collect together, and then there are not wanting persons to ascribe all their doings to the good people of the town. So when I read the summation, it gave me real clarity. I was going to say pause, but it wasn't pause. It was real clarity. And mind you, my current work is, and I've showed an image of it earlier, is American Monument, which is a nomadic monument project that looks at police brutality. So I have been for the last 4 or 5 years deeply invested in reading court transcripts, grand jury testimony, doing, 200 plus in Freedom of Information Act requests to get as much sort of documents and information in on these different cases where police have murdered unarmed Black people. And as soon as I read that, I immediately went to, or immediately conjured up for me, the grand jury testimony of Darren Wilson during the murder of Mike Brown in St. Louis, or in Ferguson, Missouri. And I have some, a little excerpt here I want to read to you guys, that according to Darren Wilson, this is his version of the events. So he's talking about his sort of justification for pulling out a gun on an unarmed 17-year-old teenager. He says, when I grabbed him, the only way I can describe it is that I felt like a 5-year-old holding on to Hulk Hogan. And so the prosecutor says, holding on to what? Holding on to a what? And he says, Hulk Hogan. That's just how big he felt and how small I felt from grasping his arm. He goes on to say, so the only other option I thought I had was my gun. I drew my gun, I turned. It is kind of hard to describe it. I turned and I go like this. He is standing there. I said, get back or I'm going to shoot you. He immediately grabs my gun and says, you are too much of a pussy to shoot me. So, later point in the transcript, he says, or the prosecutor asks, and it is your opinion that you needed to pull out your weapon because why did you feel that way? I don't want to put words in your mouth. And Wilson responds, I felt that another one of his punches in my face would knock me out or worse. I mean, it was. He obviously was bigger than I was and stronger. And I've already taken 2 to the face and I didn't think I would. And third, he could be fatal. The third one could be fatal if he hit me right. So then he goes on to say, the only way I can describe it, it looks like a demon. That's how angry he looked. He comes back toward me again with his hands up. At that point, I just went like this. I tried to pull the trigger again. Click. Nothing happened. He goes on again, almost bulking up to run through the shots, like it was making him mad and I'm shooting at him. And the face he had was looking straight at me like I wasn't even there. I wasn't even anything in his way. So for me, reading this summation against this particular transcript, and mind you, these sort of descriptions of these events where the other party is not there because the other party is dead to refute these events, it's pretty common throughout all of these transcripts that I've been looking at and over, 200 something cases. And so for me, the sort of initial point where I started was trying to track down who this man Crispus Attucks was, try to figure out his, or read the research on his genealogy. Was he Black? Was he mulatto? Was he partially Native American? All of that sort of fell away and became unimportant. Because for me, the Attucks family tree was irrelevant the minute that this record was produced for my purposes and my interests. His Blackness was produced through this record. And just as the Black body is produced through the white imaginary, the historical record is evidence of this, as are these contemporary records of Black death. So this is where I began. Because I was working at the time in Dallas and trying to put the project together before I moved to Boston, a lot of my sort of introduction to Boston and the revolutionary history was through the internet. So I was scouring the internet to see sort of what the public sort of creation of this was. And so, for instance, this is one clip from a site called Our National Parks, where they describe the old state house as a townhouse that became a great public political stage where the voices of colonists could be heard. And that word political stage began to inform sort of the ideas I was coming up with. So what resulted is a project called Crispus in July. And the full title is Crispus in July, a Requiem for a Revolutionary, aka Monument to the America Lacuna, aka a series of interventions and meditations in public space, contemplating freedom trails and trials and politicized deaths of colored citizens of the world, but in particular and very expressly, those of the United States of America. And Crispus in July is a series of public interventions that engage the mythology of Crispus Attucks and the Boston Massacre in relationship to historical Black freedom struggle and contemporary cases of police brutality. The project draws on historical records and cultural ephemera to trace the mechanisms by which whiteness produces this phenomenon called the Black body, and how ideas of Blackness formed in the white imaginary manifest into material violence against Black people. So I'm just going to share with you quickly the project. As Leah said, we, because of COVID, we intended to launch this project on July 4th this past summer, but because of the pandemic, it's been sort of tabled. And so we have a little bit more time to work on this. And as I make my move to Boston, I get to know the city, I meet people, and really begin to fill out these projects. So I'm just going to kind of share with you the sort of conceptual design, the framework of the project that are sort of like placeholders for different points of exploration that we plan to do in the future. So, as I said, Crispus in July is a series of public interventions, and we call them movements. And so it starts with a preamble, which will be a reading of John Adams' summation of the Boston Massacre trial. And it goes into the first movement, which is called the Lacuna. So this is what the old State House currently looks like. And there is the Boston Massacre, monument, or it's not a monument, but a plaque, a memorial space. I'm lost my words. It's not a monument or a plaque, but there's the Boston Massacre sort of object that was put into place in the late 1800s by the Bostonian Society as they formed their organization to commemorate this history. The marker. And so the first intervention we sort of designate this site as a temporary monument to Crispus Attucks, and the whole site is Crispus in July. And so during the day, this is what it would look like. A red carpet would sort of flood out, covering the entire block, and would go up into the old State House, over the stairs, into the space where the Crispus Attucks exhibition is. And then also there would be a covering of the marker. At night, we would change the, or so this is what it looked like at night. Let me actually just get through the slide. So okay, so let me explain. So the first intervention is establish a color field. So the red carpet, as I said, would go around the building, up into the building as a temporary recontextualization of the old State House and turning it into a monument to disrupt and challenge the freedom trail rhetoric of the traditional constructions of colonial history. And so by marking the space of the new monument, and it unifies all the sort of the individual elements that will build itself up over time throughout the run of the project. And so the color field then becomes the stage or the platform upon which other physical and performative interventions take place. And as I said, the red goes up into the steps of the old State House and into the building leading to the Crispus Attucks, at the time leading to the Crispus Attucks exhibition. The second intervention would be to change the flag on the building. Sometimes there's an American flag there, sometimes it's not, but we would be establishing this new monument by changing the flag into a glittery, sequined, bedazzled black flag that would hang over the balcony. And then the third intervention would be to cover the massacre marker with a cylinder or a cylindrical black granite sort of texture of stone that is really reflective. And it's sort of lifted off of the ground a little bit so that anyone who is able to kneel can look under and still see the original marker. And on the bottom of this sort of stone would be a mirrored surface so that the viewer could also see themselves as they're also trying to look for this marker underneath it. The fourth intervention is to trick out the building at night, is what I'm calling it, with blue LED neon lights. And then, of course, what you heard, the sound that I played would be, the sixth intervention would be to establish the monument by placing a new marker with new text and information there. And then, I guess it's not in here. Another intervention would be to put the sound in, and that was the clip that I played you. So there's a record label from the late 60s called the Black Jazz record label that's no longer exists, but it was a record label formed in Oakland to give artists, Black artists who were making political music, a chance to make their work and have distribution. And so we would, theoretically, we would be playing a mix of sound out into the night air from the Black Jazz record archive. I'm going to skip through the scenario for engagement, but I will quickly say, because I live in Dallas, where the our sort of history, our city's identity is marked by the murder of JFK here. And so in our historical district is, of course, is the Grassy Knoll. And it's a really popular tourist site. And what's really interesting to me about this site and this space is that there are these sort of public X's that appear in the middle of the street. It's not put there by the city or any of the museum that maintains that space. But people are really interested in knowing or trying to figure out where the exact space or the exact spot that JFK was hit by the bullets that killed him. So in the middle of the street is this X. And you can see it right here. And literally people play chicken with the sort of like traffic whenever there's a red light to go stand at the X and look around and take pictures. And so for me, it's really interesting when I learned that the Boston Massacre marker was actually moved from across the street later on when that area was sort of being redeveloped and moved in front of the State House. It was really interesting to me to figure out where actually the original marker went, and also if that actually marked the spot, if we could figure out where the exact spot where Crispus Attucks would have been. And so I'm bringing that into this project by creating this scenario for engagement where the public would be able, through looking at historical maps and such, be able to chart and figure out or at least give their idea of where they believe the X would be. And so they would mark this public spaces with X's. And this comes back in another movement. The uses of these X's come back in another movement. So the second movement is called the Rope Maker. And this comes from me digging into sort of Crispus Attucks' history and learning that he's a sailor and a rope maker, and also looking at the industry of rope making in Boston. And for me, as a Black woman from the South, the symbol of a rope is probably very different than most sort of how it exists in New England sort of imaginary. For me, when I thought the minute that I read he was a rope maker, immediately I thought about ropes and lynching and Black bodies and Black people being murdered and hanging from trees. And so I thought about the rope as material. I thought about what it would mean, or what it means for a Black man to have been engaged in this rope making, that this object that could, you know, could be used for a number of things, but were probably, you know, as an object that was part of this sort of like emerging economy, could go to a territory that would be used on another Black person, a Black body, to tie them up, to enslave, or to, you know, do whatever with. And so I began to think about that sort of material as a source of inspiration for the next movement. And so the intervention number seven, that's part of the second movement, theoretically would be that 2 miles of ropes are constructed in sections all across the cities with different collaborators, groups of collaborators. And when this process is done, the rope is assembled on site to be to be one sort of long rope. And at the end of the movement, it would be displayed sculpturally in the space. So here's just some textures of rope to give you an idea. The third movement is called A Dance of Utter Darkness. And one of the things that I noticed, of many things when I visited Boston, was how much reenactments are sort of part of the whole sort of culture of this, you know, learning about this history, right? So there's lots of tours with people dressed up as, you know, revolutionary heroes or colonists or redcoats or whatever. And then just the sort of culture of reenactment as well. So I began to think about that. How could I incorporate that sort of culture into the project? As I went home, I started looking more into the reenactments that happened during the city, and I found this interesting one from the Boston Globe that was an event that happened on the 240th anniversary of the massacre, and this was the children's reenactment of the Boston Massacre. And I found this really interesting. I found both the description and the images really interesting. So, for instance, this one says, the 250th anniversary of the Boston Massacre had some little redcoats involved in a reenactment and a mock trial of the incident, which took place on March 5th, 1770. They even had styrofoam snowballs. Real snowballs and ice were originally thrown at the British during the incident, which sparked the American Revolution. 10-year-old Madeline Raynor of Boston fixed her hat while in line. And then here's another image. Captain Thomas Preston of the British Army, played by Jason Hanlon, conducted his British kids group as they opened fire. Rebels lay on the ground. Jim Frederick Seven of Melrose played the dead rebel, Samuel Gray. So let me rewind. So I have this, when I got to this image, for me, I thought about, okay, for a project that's trying to sort of like make these sort of ties between this history, Attucks as this figure, potentially Attucks as, or this history being the first sort of example of, first example of our justice system sort of producing the Black body in this way. And then to be doing this project that is also attempting to bring in the discourse around the current issue of police brutality. Immediately, I went to the images of the die-ins that had been part of the first wave of the Black Lives Matter movement. And it really was sparked off, you know, a little bit, the tactic happened a little bit when people started protesting Trayvon Martin's murder, but it really sort of ramped up when people rose up to protest Mike Brown's murder. And I think that visually it was because that image of Mike Brown's body laying in the street sort of circulated nationally and internationally and created that visual sort of visual moment for people to sort of replicate. So when I saw this image, I thought about the die-ins as well. And I thought about what would it mean to incorporate these sort of gestures into the project. And so the third movement, A Dance of Utter Darkness, would be taking sort of these moments as visual inspiration, as well as this painting, looking at the different paintings where Crispus Attucks was represented. We always sort of see his body in this very like dancerly figure, this dance, this sort of really elegant, but dancer's body sort of figure. It always looks like a dance of death to me. And then also the history says that the ringing of the bells was happening during this moment and everything else. So I took these textures with me and figured out what the eighth intervention would be, which would be this death performance. So we would do a death dance reenactment in repetition over a period of time. And bringing in the X's from the previous movement, the dance would be danced on as many X's that occupy the public space that the public has put in before this moment happened. And during this dance of death that would happen over a period of time, multiple times a day, there would be the ringing of the bells. And so I started looking at Storyboard P's work as well as Bhutto's movement to sort of inspire how we could create the container to start to build that work. So these are some sort of impressionistic visuals for you to get an idea of where we would go. So the fourth movement, called Number Seven, this is a placeholder to think about.
Most of our color have been taught to stand in fear of the white man from.
Okay, sorry. So that was a reading by Angela Bassett from one of Howard Zinn's People's History of the United States stage readings. But this movement is a placeholder to think about Black Boston. So intervention number 9 would think about, we would figure out how, and working with different communities and stakeholders, would think about Black Bostonian political history pre and post Crispus Attucks, and then decide the intervention collaboratively after that. And
most
the movement is named after number 7, the 7th point in the Black Party, the Black Panther Party platform, which is we want an end to police brutality. And just to give you a sort of visual of where the title of this work is sort of riffing on and paying homage to is David Walker's appeal in 4 articles. And as you can see here, the title of the full appeal is called An Appeal in 4 Articles, Together with a Preamble to the Colored Citizens of the World, but in particular and very expressly to those of the United States of America. The 5th movement called Resurrection. So this is the final movement before our epilogue would begin. And so, of course, as I'm looking and Googling and figuring out how this space is normally used, I come upon the 4th of July, the annual 4th of July celebration that happens there, which is where this particular order emerges from the balcony to read the Declaration of Independence. And so when I first made my site visit to Boston and to this site, I immediately was drawn to that window before I even saw these images. And I thought about, what would this building say if it had a voice, if it had a spirit? Like what would emerge from it right now? And so I really sort of got obsessed with this window as a sort of portal that would like tell us something, right? And so this final movement activates this balcony. And so we thought about what would it be to have a series of live sound interventions and performances that were choreographed and performative that emerge, that start from the window and then sort of emerge and take over the space. And so here's some images, historical images, and then of course the contemporary image of the 4th of July celebration. And so for me, co-opting and appropriating that was like this. So if you can imagine a musician emerging in an unexpected moment from this balcony, playing this horn out into the air, and then musicians or other sort of sound artists would come and sort of take over the space with sound. This is kind of what I'm thinking about. And so this would happen, and this would activate, as we said, this movement is called the Resurrection. So our Crispus, our death dances happened before, and our Crispus sort of had this repetitive death performance that happened, right? And so theoretically then, when we would start this performance, our Crispus would come back, but he would be quote unquote laying in state or dead. The sound would emerge from the building, this act would happen, and the playing of the sound, the culmination of this would be causing the resurrection of Crispus, of our Crispus. And so the 11th intervention would be this closing procession.
And shineth even unto the west. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together.
A light is shining upon the nation of the west. A new day is dawning, and it's dawning in the west.
So,
and where the eagle flies.
And this is another song from the Black Jazz Archive.
So if you can imagine, our Crispus rises from the dead, unwraps this rope that has somehow been displayed in the space, and begins to lead a public to the waterfront a little bit before death, or death, dusk. And so this would be the last sort of performative interventions, and viewers would be invited to join into this procession or a ritual that would be, you know, sort of collaboratively produced and decided with different stakeholders would happen at the waterfront. So if you can imagine, this is about, I think, over a mile between the Old State House and the Boston, the wharf. And we have 2 miles of rope, and that's because I was also thinking potentially that we would make a stop over in Faneuil Hall, since this is part of this history, before going. So it's, you know, all up in the air, but these are just sort of the container for this idea. And then, of course, our epilogue would be the reading of the redacted Declaration of Independence that, as we all know, contains some references to enslaved Africans or the institution of slavery in the United States. And so we would have some sort of event to sort of recognize and pull that history out and have a public discussion around it. So that is it. That's Crispus in July. Really excited to have even just worked on the thinking or the conceptualization of the project, and hopefully in a few years we'll be able to launch it.
Yeah, just I can't believe it's been a year since you were here. I didn't realize that. Wow.
Exactly right. Like I was exactly. On a plane next week to come hang out with you guys.
Yeah. And we did a sound test from the balcony of the Old State House with a saxophone player, which was amazing. Just to kind of get that vibe going. So this is tremendous to see this all again. And I'm really excited to get you and Maria in conversation. I think Maria will be coming back here in a moment to join us. I'm particularly really struck just hearing both of you talk about your projects, thinking about how not only language, but actual court records are these sort of memorials that are then, you know, as Maria was saying, you know, we know that Ellen Garrison was actually in the courtroom that day, although the record says she wasn't. You know, the John Adams summation has made Crispus into this person that we don't know, you know, actually existed. We don't know what he really looked like. So I'm just really struck by how these documents become memorials in and of themselves that have to be kind of constantly intervened on and reread and reinterpreted so we can really fully understand what they mean or don't mean, and just how that meaning shifts over time.
I mean, I'll just start by saying thank you, Lauren, because that is profound and timely, and it's always been timely, but thank you for taking it on. And I look forward to seeing it in the landscape because it's antithetical to the landscape we see in contemporary Boston. And then I'll add from the Robbins House perspective that what seems to happen over and over and over is that Black voices and Black women's voices are discredited and not heard and not viewed. And so, you know, just like Ellen and Ida B. Wells and Rosa Parks and everyone before, during, and after them, those voices are drowned out. And so no one knows about Ellen. You know, we get 7,000 visitors a summer, and some people are gradually learning about Ellen, but they're also forgetting Ellen as soon as they leave the site, probably. That there is an oppressive narrative that is hard to fight against. And so the kinds of exhibits that Lauren is creating can impact people in a profound way that hopefully becomes a visceral connection to these ideas that stays with people for a long time, because we're fighting a huge counter narrative that's been established from slavery to today to confirm and perpetuate a narrative that allows some people to remain comfortable and others to remain woefully uncomfortable.
I think I'll just jump in and echo Leah, and thank you both for these fantastic presentations and very different approaches to thinking about where history is found. And Maria, you beautifully spoke to this ebb and flow of history and the way that history resurfaces and the images and the events of the present in often very unexpected ways, as Lauren, I think you've showed. On this idea of kind of finding new narratives, counter narratives, Lauren, I was struck by what you said about a counter-memorial practice or an anti-monument making. And so much of your work, as you've shown, and I'll just say that this is a starting question and we'll of course get to all of our audience questions soon. So please do add them as I pose this first question. But in all of the projects that you showed us, you know, the Dallas Drinking Fountain, American Monument, Crispus in July, you're clearly creating or engaging with this idea of monument making, the lexicon of monuments. But what I'm struck by is that you're really giving presence to history actually by underscoring an absence. And in this sense, perhaps it's not so much monument, but as you're talking about memorial. And so there's something that I'd love to hear you kind of tease apart those differences. But beyond that, I guess I'm wondering in your work related to monument making, what power have you found lies within the format that you use, which is really kind of emphasizing almost a rupture of time or drawing attention to what hasn't been recorded as history versus the more traditional approach to monument making, which is the statue erected to bring history very forcefully into the present moment?
Yeah, I mean, when I began sort of this practice, I come out of a filmmaking, traditional filmmaking education background. I went into art school making experimental cinema and videos and things. And then, and it was only there because I came from a traditional film background. I actually knew nothing really about art and the art world. And it was in art school I started to be introduced to all of this, and particularly like being introduced to monuments, memorials, the discourses around that. And so when I got interested, and mind you, the Drinking Fountain Project didn't start before this moment, but the incidents that sparked it happened, which was they found these white-only traces in this public record, in this public building in Dallas, this county building. And so that happened before I started grad school. And I had always taken that moment with me and thinking that something needed to happen there. So it wasn't until I started learning about the Maya Lin's Vietnam Memorial, Peter Eisenman's Memorial to the Murdered Jews of Europe, and learning about the practice of counter monument making and anti monuments, that it clicked for me, right? And but for me, my interest was like, I'm not a sculptor. I'm not interested in granite and stone necessarily, even though this would be like my first time using it in this project, which I was excited about. By the way, shout out to Tori Fair if she's here, because she helped me find like stone people and everybody else to source in Boston. But it clicked for me the moment I started studying monuments and that discourse, because for me, stone, granite was like the material of the dead, of the dead thing. And cinema for me is a public art form in and of itself, and a way that memory gets translated for better or for worse, right? And so my interest really was how to bring in the new materials of memorializing, of monument making, using moving images. Like that's where I began. And actually, I think this project probably, well, so it still is using the language of cinema, right? We just don't have necessarily video projection, but I am relying on my sort of like education around cinema and dramatic storytelling to sort of frame or to structure this project. So for me, making these history living again is the place where I began in thinking about monument making and memorializing. And so this would be the first time that like doing the performative act of happenings and staging interventions in this way would be the primary material to try to engage the history. And the only sort of thing I haven't figured out yet is the fact that these are all sort of ephemeral objects or monuments, and what does that mean, you know, when they can't live past a certain moment? Does it really accomplish what the sort of initial purpose is, if really the power lies in longevity, right? When we talk about monuments in public space, so
can you leave something behind?
Yeah, well, so that's one thing, right, is to like try to negotiate leaving something behind. And so the project American Monument that I'm currently working on and probably will be working on for the rest of my life, it's engaged, it's conceived to travel across the country. And the idea is that at each site that it would leave something behind, that each sort of partner that would be hosting this project would be so engaged they would take on something. So for instance, where it is at University of California, Irvine right now, the thing that they will live with or will be stewarding is the online database that we're creating. So they will actually create the virtual presence in the database, and then it will be hosted there hopefully forever. Mm-hmm. And then also the other piece of it is that potentially each site leaves a speaker there so that wherever the monument is, the sound can be transmitted to that speaker over time. Mm-hmm. But again, the sort of tech piece of it, like this, that's the ephemeral part too, right? Like if, mm-hmm. you know, whatever, alien invasion happens, things blow up, and then the next sort of generation of whatever beings come, like they may not know, yeah. they may not know anything about this, you know?
I think that's the reason to try and find a way to leave something behind, because mm-hmm. if you come to Concord, you'll see the Minuteman statue by Daniel Chester French. And mm-hmm. Daniel Chester French also created the Lincoln Memorial, right? Mm-hmm. And so we've got this iconic sculptor who's created the iconic farmer who's more svelte, right? And mm-hmm. probably taller and more handsome than what the farmers looked like during the Minuteman and the Revolutionary War in Daniel Chester French's interpretation. And nowhere in the landscape then are the alternative scenarios to that. Mm-hmm. And so children learn that's kind of the connection to the through line of the making of America. Mm-hmm. And so to leave something behind, a statue, even a granite statue, or even writing the Blacks on the Civil War memorials who fought in the war, that's the fight we're fighting now, is how to get that balanced narrative. Someone wrote in the chat or the Q&A a question around, I can't remember how it was put, maybe Leah or Caitlin can read it, but a question around, do you agree with, you know, getting rid of these monuments or adding monuments? And I literally think whatever you choose to do, we need to add the monuments that explain that Black Americans and BIPOC, Indigenous and persons of color, you know, to Nicole Hannah Jones's point, helped to make this country. And the only way we're actually going to be able to have a reckoning or transformative justice is to balance that narrative. So whatever you can leave behind, it should be considered a part of the mandate.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I can ask, John Park asks this question, and maybe that's a good time to jump into this. So he says that it seems to me that with the recent removal of Civil War statues that are offensive, there could be a better narrative for the public explaining why this is happening. Do you agree? And what should the new narrative be in the future? By the way, I agree with the removals. Thank you, John.
I mean, I can take this or start off. I mean, so one, I have been engaged in Confederate monuments for the last 15 years. So I had actually created a sketch up a proposal for the Lee statue in Dallas as a part two to the Drinking Fountain Project. So just to give a little background, the Drinking Fountain Project was a project I launched independently, learned how to raise money, do all of this stuff. And so it took 10 years to finish that project that I ran out of steam and couldn't get to the next project, which was this addressing these Confederate monuments in Dallas. And initially, when I thought about this back in 2006, before the national zeitgeist, mind you, there were moments on the record in Dallas where people had tried to get this monument taken down, like starting in the early 90s was the earliest that I could find. And it was just sort of like spontaneous and you know, came up, went away. So for me, the initial project was just to make people realize they were there again, right? Because we have all of these things peppering our public space that we actually do not see anymore because they've been always with us. So the initial project was just to like drape it,
undrape it, make people see it again, and then began a public collaborative process to decide what to do. And I ran out of steam and energy so that by the time, so I didn't launch the project. And then, of course, what we know, like it sort of really came up with the first wave of the Black Lives Matter movement. These objects started to be like looked at and addressed and became really these sites to project the current political sort of moment onto an address, right? So I was really heavily involved with it. And here in Dallas, I helped to ghostwrite the sort of a resolution to take them down, but it never was that simple. But I always maintained a more nuanced position, which was actually, I believe the project is of recontextualization, not contextualization. Like we need something more than just another plaque next to this object that says, this is what this thing is, and this is what it means, and who's absent, and who's this and that. That doesn't actually undo the power of that object. And the thing is that these objects, as you said, Maria, they're powerful because of the form, because of the aesthetics, because of what they do to our bodies and what they do to our minds unconsciously. And so a, you know, 70-foot tall statue, a little plaque next to it, doesn't even begin to address or equal that power dynamic. So, but for me, recontextualization could start to address some of that. And recontextualization is literally taking objects and changing the communicative function. So what for me that meant was that if we had decided, as we decided in our resolution for the city, this that was voted on, that these objects no longer represent our city, our culture, our people, then they're not sacred anymore. So that means that we can take them and we can do whatever with them. And that to me is the way of like speaking to the history that these objects represent and what they point to, speaking to the struggle to take them down, speaking them to our contemporary moment. So I was really pushing, and I actually did another actual project proposal to start to recontextualize the monuments here in Dallas. But it was such a hot political issue that although the council people were behind this closed doors for the project, they could never go on the record to be for the project because the discourse around these monuments has become so binary. It's either you remove them, you're with us or against us, remove it or leave it up. And if you're for leaving it up in any kind of capacity, you're against, right? So I just thought we could have a more nuanced response to it. I do believe the spontaneous taking down by the public is important, but the state, the city sanctioned taking down is a different act. And that's the space where I think we could be a little bit more thoughtful and real about what we're leaving behind concerning this moment. So that's my sort of position that was not necessarily popular, but yeah. I don't know, Maria, what is your thoughts on all of that?
Yeah.
And I think it is a case by case basis too, also, right?
Well, it's interesting because what these monuments do to our psyche, of course, is to validate a narrative. And so I had the wonderful opportunity to going to the to Montgomery, right, Alabama and Selma a couple of years ago. And the visceral reaction I had to standing in front of the courthouse or the Capitol in Montgomery, to look up and see Jefferson Davis in a large statue on the left side was one thing. But to be a Black American woman and see that they put Jefferson Davis on one side and Marion Sims on the other side. Marion Sims is a huge statue on the right side flanking the Capitol of Montgomery, Alabama. And Marion Sims mutilated a lot of Black enslaved women in order to create modern gynecology in the speculum. And so to see these things, you know, and then people are having weddings and going up and down the stairs and taking photos of themselves as, you know, lovely couples were in front of the Montgomery, Alabama. To see that, you know, just again, destabilizes our sense of belonging in America and our sense of how idiotic Americans are in the ignorance of American history. And so, you know, you see that and you cringe. But at the same time, you see what Mississippi changed its state flag. So these flag is a monument, statues are monuments. It's a constant battle that Blacks are out in the front of. trying to explain to people, if you knew your history, you'd probably make a lot of changes. And so I'm fine with keeping them up if you put in balance the truth and a little, you know, in good artistic and narrative interpretive practice, a caption that says, you know, we don't know why Marion Sims is here, but since he's here, let us tell you what he really did, right? Let us tell you the names of the women that he mutilated in order to create the speculum that, you know, you experience at every gynecological exam, for example, or Jefferson Davis. So, you know, the work of the artist and the work of sculptors is important, and to support that work is important.
Maria, I have a question about kind of a follow-up, I suppose, but we're talking about, you know, the power of the traditional monument and the power of that pedestal. But at the same time, one of the things that I was struck by in your research is the intimacy of going through Ellen Garrison's letters and where you found history. And I think that's something, it was drawn out actually in another exhibition at the Rose this past semester, Dora Garcia, where actually, you know, the words, the work of women is often preserved in these smaller documents, these letters, because they weren't necessarily given that platform. So I'm curious if in your work, thinking about the legacy of Ellen Garrison in this part of the country, and if you're, as you're working to share that and shed light on it, is there a way that you're thinking about maintaining that sense of intimacy that you felt in uncovering this history?
So we, just like everyone, you know, participating in this discussion, we were just citizens, right? We aren't artists, we aren't historians. Some call us public historians because, you know, we live here, we wanted to know about our environment, when and we wanted to know about our culture. So first of all is the agency and responsibility of understanding where you are and taking up the call to understand where you are, and digging into that and researching the history with a dogged determination. And then to share that with the public, that's the call to arms, because the history that we're talking about, it's all buried and sometimes buried in plain sight. And so the intimacy of it is truly just planting your feet on the ground and saying, where am I? What truly happened here? And how am I going to dig into it and find out the truth? I say that because we had to ask those questions ourselves. And we had to, as non-historians, the core focus of our work and the first group to ask these questions, we were moms. We were moms who wanted to know what we were going to be telling our kids. Mm-hmm. We were moms who knew we were in an historic town, Concord, but that we didn't know what kids who were bused in from Boston and Metco were being told, right? They're being told, you're coming to this town because it has a great educational system and they're willing to accept you. But meanwhile, the narrative of this town has a lot of Black history, and that it connects to Crispus Attucks, right? I mean, we're talking about that Revolutionary War pathway from Boston to Concord, and who helped along that way. And there were Blacks who died on the North Bridge in that first successful battle. And there were Blacks who helped build the economy. I mean, trillions of dollars they've equated it to in building the American economy. So it's a long-winded answer to your question. It's all intimate if you plant your feet into the ground and ask, what were the indigenous people doing here first? Are we erasing that legacy? Are we erasing how they taught the colonists how to plant corn? Are we erasing the knowledge of how the first Africans taught the colonists how to plant rice? And why are we erasing it? And if we know it's being erased, why aren't we investigating and teaching it and promoting it?
Well, I think that's the perfect answer, and actually is probably the perfect end to our program, although we could go on for longer. I thank everyone who stayed with us for this hour and a half, and really huge thanks to all of our participants. I'll turn it over to Ganit to close us out.
Well, thank you so much, those who stayed with us, and our wonderful moderators, Leah and Caitlin, but most especially Lauren and Maria, for your incredible work of bringing to all of us archiving. I mean, finding all the untold stories, all the invisibilized individuals and communities. And really, only through memory can we move forward. This is our closing program, and wonderful. I think it tells you what we plan to do, what we are doing and plan to do moving forward at the Rose. First of all, bringing our brilliant and inspiring Brandeis colleagues to engage with us and really just hearing your voices and learning from you. Also, kind of collaborating with other organizations and people. We are not the only, you know, we're not the source of knowledge, but we can collaborate and bring together new knowledge or bring new knowledge together, whatever you like. So thank you to Robbins House, Revolutionary Spaces, Now and There. This Friday, the Rose Art Museum is gonna close along with Brandeis University for the holidays. We're gonna deinstall the show. But the good news is that we will reopen in 2021. I'm sure everyone is happy to say bye-bye to 2020. It was not an easy year. And I just want to tell you that we are planning to reopen with our 60th anniversary exhibition. I'm leading a curatorial team that includes Caitlin Rubin, but also our brilliant new guest curator for African and African diaspora art, Dr. Eliane Hill. And I think the work that you have illustrated, the work of undoing the master's tools and thinking about new ways of showing art and making meaning through art, and the multiple narratives that need to be told. It's a work in progress, and I have to say that for Caitlin and I, it's a labor of love. We are thanking you for joining us, but we really hope to see you, hopefully in person, in 2021 to celebrate our 60th anniversary and our new exhibition. So thanks, everyone. And Maria, Lauren, what can I say?
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
See you soon.